Hi guys, what's up? How are you? And today there is cava versus champagne. Today we will check which are the differences between these two famous traditional methods, sparkling wine, and one very famous, quite prestigious, and the other one a bit less famous, but that is coming out quite a lot in the past few years. So stay tuned. Okay, so let's start with the cava. So cava comes from Catalonia, Spain mainly. 95% of the all cava production comes from there. And I choose in Codorno. Codorno is basically the first estate that started to produce cava in the 1872. So the cava production started because the owner of Codorno went to France to do a trip to France, and he went to discover the Champagne region in France, that's close to Paris. And so he got in love with the Champenoise method at that time was coming out. And so he brought this knowledge to Catalonia, to Penedès specifically, and in a little town in the middle of the Penedès, he started the production of the first Spanish champenoise method, or traditional method. So in the beginning was called Champana, but then due to EU regulation, and in my opinion it is correct, they had to change the name to cava. Cava means cellar. A lot of their cellars are under mountains. They are huge, especially Codorno and also Freycinet are the two biggest. They are also two of the biggest sparkling estate producers in the world in terms of bottles and square meter. So they started to produce these nice champenoise method, and then we will see now the differences. So first of all, as I said, the region, the cava DO, all the cava comes mainly from Catalonia, mainly from Penedès, even if it can be done in Rioja, Navarra, Valencia, but mainly comes from only this area. So the grapes are different. The main grape that are grown in the area are Parellada, Macabeo, and Xarello. With Macabeo, also known as Viura in Rioja, is usually 50% of the blend, and then you have Xarello, that is the more aromatic one, and that gives that earthy touch that we will see shortly. And then there is also Parellada, that gives the classic finesse, it's a bit lighter. And these Codorno vintage 2018 is made only with these three grapes. Also now it can be used Chardonnay. It's becoming quite popular, the Chardonnay, for the white version. We do also have the Rosé version, that is made with Garnacha or Grenache, Pinot Noir mainly. So these are the main two grapes used for the cava rosé. Anyway, today we will check the classic two white versions. I'm Michele Blato, I'm an Italian sommelier. I started my career in Italy a few years ago, and then I moved to London. I studied in Italy and in the UK, and this channel is made for you, to help you to sail through the wine and spirit world easily, finding some hidden wine gems, hidden spirit gems, understand what to buy, understand the differences between two categories. So if this is the channel you are looking for, please subscribe to the channel and give the thumb up. It will be very appreciated. So another important difference is the aging requirement. So basically in the bottle, second fermentation has to happen in 9 months at least. Instead in the champagne, we will see it's higher in terms of month. So we will find a different wine compared to a longer time on the east. Longer time in the east, 15 months, you get to a Riserva, and then you go to a Gran Riserva to 30 months, and then a Gran Cru Riserva, so when there is a specific vintage, for 36 months. Okay, so here we are with a bit of cava poured in the glass, and now let's check the color first. I would say that is a straw yellow color, quite pale. The bubbles are quite thin and persistent, however a bit less, I believe, I expect in the champagne. Let's go into the nose now. Okay. So a lot of fruitiness. There is a lot of fruit. I recognize immediately the earthy touch that I was mentioning earlier. So citrusy note. A bit of white flowers. A bit of also tropical notes as well. This fantastic Xarello, I can feel it immediately. There is this kind of earthy, little bit burn touch. I don't know how to explain, honestly, a little bit, but it's quite unique. I feel a little bit of minerality coming out, and a little bit of yeast as well. Okay, so let's go now into the palate. The wine is extremely fresh, delicate, light. I would say perfect as aperitif. You feel this fruitiness. It's a kind of mix between citrusiness and tropical notes as well. And you feel in now coming out as an aftertaste all these earthy touch of the Xarello. That is the quite unicity of this cava, is the main signature in my opinion for the white version. So cava is extremely good as aperitif, as I said, with light dishes, with the seafood in general, and with tapas. We all know that comes from Catalonia, so when you go to Catalonia, please go in these lovely places where you have cava all the time with the tapas. That they are really, really a great match, because cava cleans basically your palate from the little untoast things and very savory things, and also prepare your stomach basically for the main meal. That is also another great feature of this wine. Very, very nice, very, very easy going, perfect for parties. Ah, indeed, if you want to see a video that I made, here in the description below there is the link to how to choose a wine for a wedding that can be really useful, and cava is one of the wines that I mentioned in the sparkling category. So, as we said, extremely light, extremely enjoyable, very easy going. The price point is quite competitive. You can get this wine around, I would say, 10 to 12 euros or $15 easily. You can find everywhere in the world easily. You can normally find even in the supermarket. But now they are starting to increase, however, the quality and with the aging requirement. So I'm seeing a lot of more small firms that are increasing and hitting qualities over quantities. So that is basically, so that is our cava. I hope it was useful, and now let's move on. So if you are enjoying the video, please give the thumb up and click the notification bell and subscribe to the channel so you won't miss any new video coming out. And also this will help me with the YouTube algorithm, and it will support me in making more video in the future. Thank you very much, I really appreciate it. So this channel is basically made for people that are looking to increase their knowledge in the wine and spirit world industry. They want to understand more the characteristic and the main feature of the different wines from around the world, and spirits as well. So this is the channel for you. So if this is the channel you're looking for, please subscribe and give the thumb up. And now let's move on with the champagne. So champagne comes from France, from we're not too far from Paris, and it doesn't come from all the old France. And this region is quite cool, cooler for sure compared to the Catalonia. And the grape grounds are different. We do have Chardonnay, Pinot Noir and Pinot Meunier mainly. 99% of the production is made by these three grapes. And the soil is different. Calcareous soil that gives a quite minerality into the wine, that transmit to the wine this quite salinity that you will feel. The sun radiation, it is also different in being much cooler and northern part of the Europe. So this affects all the days. The aging requirement also, it is longer, so the minimum time that the yeast have to spend in contact with the wine in the bottle is 15 months, instead in cava were 9 months. So these are all things that affect the final product and the price as well, I would say. So here we are with the champagne. I have a La Cuvée Laurent Perrier, a classic cuvée, a normal cuvée, where we do have the classic blend. So let's see, the color is pretty the same as the cava, so a straw pale yellow. I do see a little bit more bubbles, so it's more persistence, there are more, a bit more bubbles, so this tells me that there is a little bit of higher pressure in the wine due to the longer aging requirement also. Then we do see that the bubbles are thinner also and they are more persistent. Let's check the nose now. Oh, completely different. So here I feel much more brioche, toastiness, yeasty notes compared instead to the cava that we have seen more fruitiness. I feel a bit of minerality as well. Citrusy notes as well, a little bit even here, and tropical notes a bit more pronounced, like a banana, a little bit of mango, but very subtle. So very completely different nose. I would say there are more different layers of complexity. So, but let's check the palate now. Okay. So more acid. So there is more acidity. The cooler climate, you can really feel it. I feel a lot of salinity and minerality, that is one of the main features of the champagne. I feel even here a little bit of toastiness. I feel much more the yeasty note, the yeasty touch of the wine, and even here a little bit of citrusness and tropical note, but very very subtle. So the fizziness is a bit more pronounced. I feel more the fizziness, but let's try again. A little bit heavier in body, I would say, also compared to the cava we had. Okay, so and these were the two wines, so cava versus champagne. So, but let's do now a quick recap, a quick comparison again. So we have seen the cava that comes from Spain, from Catalonia specifically, so quite Mediterranean climate, compared instead to the champagne that comes from a region not too far from Paris, a much cooler region. So these affect the maturation, the ripeness of the grapes. So the soil is different. In Champagne we have this calcareous soil, instead in cava, in Penedès, where is the main region, is a bit of mixture of gravel, pebble, and also a little bit of calcareous soils, but That affects the taste differently because the champagne has this much more minerality in the palate, salinity. Instead, the cava has less minerality. The cava has a much more pronounced fruitiness, and due to the fact that it is aged less in the bottle, in the yeast, it stays less in contact with the yeast, so we do have more citrusy notes, floral notes, and it is a little bit lighter in body. We do have also this characteristic earthy touch, very quite unique. Champagne, so we do have more brioche, more toastiness, more yeastiness on the nose, and a little bit of citrusy notes and tropical notes as well, but I would say very subtle. And in the palate is a little bit heavier in body and more acidic, and with this quite salinity felt quite a lot in the palate. So the grapes used are different. So in cava we do have mainly Macabeo, Xarello and Parellada. In champagne we do have Chardonnay, Pinot Noir and Pinot Meunier mainly. And then the aging requirement, as I said, the aging requirement in the champagne is much longer, so that's why we do have also a higher price compared to the cava, even if they are made with the same traditional method. So these are some of the main features, the main differences. These also affect what we can pair. So cava is, I would say, great as aperitif, as a starting point of your meal, and goes perfectly with seafood and tapas. Champagne also goes well with aperitif, but it can have a wider range of dishes, of pairing. So you can go even with some pasta, maybe you can go even with some light meat. It depends also which kind of champagne. So I hope this has been useful for you. I hope you had a clearer understanding of the main difference of just these two famous sparkling wines. So if you want to see also a video where I compare Prosecco versus champagne, here in the description below, I'm sure you can find another great video for you. So I hope to see you again in the next one. I want to thank you for your time in watching this video, and please don't forget to subscribe to the channel, give the thumb up and click the notification bell. I'll see you in the next one. Ciao.